On behalf of the alumni office team, I welcome you to the 17th edition of Saturday Musings, hosted by the alumni office. We will begin today's session with a keynote address by Professor YLR Moorthi. Professor YLR Moorthi teaches brand management, creative marketing, and marketing courses at IIMB. He's an M.Tech from IIT Madras and a PGP batch of 88 alumnus of IIM Bangalore. He's also a PhD in brand management from Bharatidasan University. A warm welcome to you, sir.
Yeah, so I was asked to talk about brands in the morning and welcome this Saturday morning to. There must be some pull for this place called IIM Bangalore, where so many people want to come in on a Saturday morning, where there are so many interesting things to do in IIM or outside. I'll start off first with the, and the panelists will come later. How is the?
Yes, sir.
Right, so I'll do this. The story on how to build oneself as a brand. Okay, so I was told that 25 minutes is the time I'm given, and I'm very conscious of that. And drop dead time is 30 minutes, so we will go by the clock. And after that, we'll invite the panel members here, and a max of 1.5 hours of everything put together, which is our panel discussion plus the Q&A, and we should be going good for 12:30, we should close. That's the agenda. So we'll start off. All right, shall I? Okay. Yeah. I think the first point, really, when one thinks of branding self, is the question of how one stands out. A fundamental thing, really, in all brands is the standout. And that's the reason you buy a Colgate or a paper boat and not something else, because that stands out for some reason, at least in your mind. And you know, so all the movies he made were bold and controversial. The first one, for instance, I mean, not necessarily in chronological order, 2001 A Space Odyssey was the first sci-fi film made. And all your Christopher Nolan, all these great guys actually bow to this man and then start the Sri Ganesh is this fellow. So, and A Clockwork Orange, which is the a rather disturbing novel by Anthony Burgess, which was made into a film later. And the film is about disturbed kids in adolescents in London, in the city of London, okay? And how their violence actually impacts them and the society. I read the novel, it's a deeply disturbing novel. And of course, Lolita, this is even more difficult. It's a very tough subject to even tackle. The subject that marginally deals with the issue of incest, even more difficult, in fact, to handle on screen. Very difficult kind of themes he took up and won rave reviews, very critical kind. So if you look at this, the one adjective that comes out when you think of this man is bold, always pushing the envelope kind of thing. And then you come to the Desi Great, for instance, that not many people know really that our man is known for actually for variety. For instance, something like Shatranj Ke Khiladi is basically historical, okay? And something like Gopi Gayan, Bhaga Bayan is basically a fantasy. And Ganeshathru is a social drama, and so on. If you go through the anthology of Ray, in fact, lots of films are, in fact, he himself said in interviews that I tried not to repeat myself. So no genre, in fact, except for one or two films which were repetitions of the same poverty theme kind of a thing. The rest of them were actually autobiographical sketches, biographical sketches, lots of interesting themes like this. And then you come to the popular Bollywood directors like Hrishikesh Mukherjee. He was once asked, and some of the best films actually of the 70s were made by him, blockbuster hits which were middle of the road commercial films like Chupke Chupke and Golmaal. There were movies made after this with the same name, Bowing to that man, but nothing like the originals. If you've seen the 70s originals, nothing like it. It was an amazing director. In fact, he was once asked apparently, why don't you make movies like Satyajit Ray? And apparently he said, I can't. I make movies about people like me, that is the middle class. I can't make movies about them. I don't know if he can make movies about middle class, but I can't make movies about that hi-fi kind of stuff that he does. Right, so that's Hrishikesh Mukherjee. And then you have a Tamil director called Bharathi Raja, some of you who probably know this guy. The record he holds is, I think, something like 10 movies which ran for 100 days, you know, one after the other, a string of hits. I didn't see many of his movies. I follow the language though. I didn't see one or two, but he's probably a very distinct kind of a director. And the common theme that runs across almost all of them is in all of them mega hits and all of them with anonymous actors, and the story runs the brilliant guy. He came from stage and the overriding story is actually to room. So there's one thing, and you even before you get into this guy's movies, you know you're going to see something about the village. There's a sort of, he sort of frames the expectation right from the beginning, and then his own country cousin, who later became very famous all over the country. Many of his themes are basically urban, fairly sophisticated kind of themes. For instance, Roja, which was about patriotism and stuff like that, and Monoragam, which was essentially about what happens, you know, it's a very sort of cliched story, but presented very bright, very smartly. What happens when you marry a man you don't love? That's it. That's the story, but very smartly and very softly dealt with, brightly dealt with. And of course, this one, which is I think 100th reinterpretation of Ramayana, I think. Yeah, the Indians can't get over these epics. It's so deeply ingrained in us, crazy. And of course, one name which you probably have not heard. This is a movie director from Telugu. A very interesting character. And probably the one who holds as good a record as Bharati Raja. I think 13 of his films ran for 50 days or 100 days, right from his first film. 13 films, one after the other. I mean, it's very difficult to get the act right so many times. And then somebody asked him, what's the, and in marketing jargon, this is called positioning, you know. The word you put in somebody's mind about yourself, that's called positioning. And this is the interesting thing. And this, he said, is, he quite plainly said, and I was wondering why nobody did this. He said, my one person I'm looking at is the housewife. That's it. That's my audience. I'm not looking at the rest. And he was asked why. He said, it's very simple. If a man comes, he comes alone. If a kid comes, he comes alone. If the woman comes, he comes with both of them. I have 4 tickets, end of the story. It's an obvious thing, and it wonders why, no wonder so many films were hits. I don't know why the rest of the idiots don't make movies like this. It just, it takes very bright mind, you know, with so much detail and so many things to say and so many stories to tell. How is it that somebody identifies and just nails it the way it should be? It's amazing how somebody got the story right. Just think about it. How often does a woman go to a movie alone? I mean, is somebody going along with her, right? I mean, so you're sure of at least one more ticket, you're done. You've doubled your intake. What a bright way of thinking. And if it's a family, then 4. Chief, the day is made, right? So that's the, so in other words, in all these things, the first thing probably a brand, whether it is a personal brand or a brand in itself, a product or a service, I think the first thing probably is it should stand out. That's Sri Ganesh, start off. Straight off the bat, that's the first thing. And now that we have said that a brand should stand out, so there are 2 things that probably matter. One is called difference and the other is called relevance. 2 things that probably matter for any brand anywhere in the world, and irrespective of who you are and what you are, product, service, whatever. So difference is how you stand out. We have seen some illustrations of that already. And relevance is answering a need in somebody's life. This A must be pardoned. Answering a need in somebody's life. There is a need for something, and something comes and fills us. It's either expressed or it's a latent need, any which way. An example of this in personal branding. 2 names of homegrown heroes, Narayan Moorthi and something very interesting about both these people. The first one being, these are the guys who actually broke. It was the early days of 80s and so on. 81 was when Moorthi started. 81 was also the time when I think Wipro started. Not many remember that the full form of Wipro is Western India Vegetable Products. It started actually as a edible oil company, diversified into a huge number of other things. Now, what matters in this domain actually is your brainware and not how much capital you have, which was really how the old time capitalism was running the country. One other thing these people didn't have, the new age entrepreneurs didn't have, is there was no need for blocking licenses, which is how the old age guys actually made their money. Just block the license, almost like coolies in coolies would block berths in unreserved compartments in railway stations. And after that, somebody should get another permission for making edible oil or something else. And only then he would be able to, but the capacity is blocked. So there's no way you can actually get into the industry. It was virtually monopolizing car. It led to all sorts of difficulties. But the first thing difference was really that they didn't have to, they had brainware and they had something more than license. And this was another interesting departure from the previous capitalists who actually were doing all sorts of things. And even today, we see lots of accusations of crony capitalism and so on, and many of them true. It's true in most countries, not just our country. Almost all countries in the world. In fact, only yesterday I read an article in The Economist which said that is democracy compromised everywhere in the world? And he was talking about the president of Hungary, he was talking about whole lot of countries where once a man comes to power, he doesn't go out. Sounds familiar? Yeah. So how they are actually capturing institutions and so on. So there is an issue here in terms of people are getting more and more. People were pissed off with democracy for some time now, but they have never given up. Increasing cynicism about democracy is extremely dangerous for the way we live, because there are some difficulties here, but I don't think we really want dictatorships. I don't know if you really want to get there, but that's really the... So this is in fact from another world, right? And of course, cliched one, but fairly well known, so I thought I'll take you through this very quickly. Address, simplicity, truth, pleasant. And the most interesting thing about the man was even many of his enemies were finding it difficult to resist his charm. Yeah, Lord Reading, who was one of the last viceroys in the country, says, I think the British understood them much better than we did as worthy opponents. And Lord Reading was saying, Gandhi is 50% shrewd politician, 25% saint, and 25% complete humbug. It's amazing how he, almost like chemical analysis, tells you what that man is. Very pleasant, and he even made shoes for the man who jailed him and sent him as a gift. And very few people actually do that. It's difficult to resist a person like that. The interesting thing is how he became relevant was he made it a mass movement through this thing called non-cooperation. And it again came from comes from the simplicity of not just being, but also thought, amazingly simple thought. Brilliant, absolutely, in a country in which people were just allowing foreigners to just coming and loot us for generations. It's not the first time. And imagine how many foreigners came in before the Brits came in. Hundreds of years we were invaded in this country. This is it. Non-cooperation is just this, that's it. It's extremely easy to do. Don't side with the British, which means what? Stay home, don't go to work. That's all. The machinery will come to a standstill. It's a brilliant one. How many fellows will you jail? The only worry is if this becomes a mass movement, and it's very easy, and it goes very close to the heart, which is bunking classes, bunking work, bunking. Yeah, it's very close to heart. Actually, people were warning him when he did this, that this can continue after freedom, whenever that comes. And you can see what's happening in IIM and other places after that. Right? So this is it. Just stay home. Amazing. It's an extremely simple thing. How can it be stopped? How can it be stopped? If 1 billion people want to do it, how will you get them? And if you've seen this movie, Gandhi, brilliantly done after an effort of 20 years, the fellow says, he jumps in. At some point, the Governor General asks him, the Viceroy asks him, Mr. Gandhi, do you expect us to just get up and go? Yes, Your Excellency, that's precisely what I expect you to do. And whatever you do, a small bunch of people, maybe 1,000 or a few thousands of British officers, will not be able to control all of us unless we actively cooperate with you. And we are refusing cooperation. Irrespective of how much you do and what you do, you will simply not be able to govern us unless we assist you. I hope you realize that. We are asking you to go. Go now. You will have dignity and honor. Is this a warning? Is it a threat or is it a request? That's why it's very difficult to size that man. That's the That's the beauty. And this, just one principle, and he actually multiplied it 100 times. Nothing. And a brilliant idea, very simple, brilliant idea. Made it a mass scale, what is called typically the management guys call scaling the scaling up. That's the scaling up story. Brilliant, absolutely. Okay, and now Partha, who is as usual evanescent, asked me to tell us something about what the books say. I don't know if it's a very bright idea, but let's do it quickly and as painlessly as possible. The last thing on you want on a Saturday morning is more jargon. I'm sure we have learned enough and more. Academically, there are three concepts that come close to personal branding. And the first one is what is called cult branding. How does one become a cult? Something like a Salman Khan. Yeah. With every new movie of his, he makes 100 crores more or some such thing. Nobody knows why. Nobody knows why, including the fellows who are watching him. So it's crazy, absolutely, that you can't understand. Or another guy called Rajnikant. Yeah, he's 60 plus, he's balding, he doesn't even bother to make up, he doesn't shave when he's outside. I mean, he's an incredible guy. I mean, that fellow having that kind of hold on masses is amazing. How is it that one personal brand becomes so strong that people simply can't get away? That's called a cult brand. A cult brand is something which you don't want to judge. You stop judging. And almost all brands want to get there. Very few of them get there. Very few of them even become brands. And to become a cult brand is a very, from there to good, from the good to strong and strong to cult, I think it's a very, very long journey. And then you have another thing called services branding. Understand that when we are interacting with others, others are interacting with us because you are of some use to them. In some sense, you are my service and I am your service. Otherwise, we won't be interacting with each other. There is some service angle to every encounter, or we won't even be having a conversation. There's no need for you to talk to me or the other way around. So there are two stories here. One is called experience good and the other is called credence good. Without going into the complications of this, typically an experience good is where 50% of the goods, whatever it is product, and 50% is service, which means something like a bank, an airline, a credit card, etc. These are typically where the experience part or the intangible part is as important as the tangible part, almost equally important, and which is why it's somewhat funny that we actually go to a restaurant, okay, for the dosa being hot is important, but the server smiling is also important. Why should he smile? You didn't go there for that, right? Yeah, but somehow you actually tend to reject the dosa when the fellow doesn't smile. Which means you go for the product and reject it for the service. It's a very funny thing that happens in experience goods. In fact, in all services where you actually go for the project and reject product and reject it because somehow you're not happy with the service. It's a very strange kind of a thing that happens, and it happens in services. The more the intangible increases, the more the dependence on the person increases. And then you go to what is called credence goods, which are essentially what are called professional services. You don't understand them, which is why you need an auditor or a tax consultant to fill your form. Yeah. So, a consultancy or a super specialization, for every part of the body, there's a surgeon now. There's a separate pediatric surgery. Pediatrician itself is a specialization. Pediatric surgery is further, it's amazingly difficult. Imagine how do you operate for a 10 month old baby. I mean, you have to perform some operations on that. Some problem in the heart. It's extremely, very, very difficult auditors. All these guys here, the tangible is only 20 and the intangible is something like 80. You have no clue. You don't have a clue of what the fellow is saying. I've tried all my life to understand contracts, whereas that, and so for now on, I have no clue of what the fellow has written, just sign it. Yeah, take it to a lawyer, okay? Hopefully he understands. Then you are safe, otherwise you are dead. Yeah? So that's the, so these are the, there's one other thing called search goods where it's 80 and 20, the other way around, and those are typically durables. Now, the cult brands are typically public figures, celebrities, and so on. It's very easy for them to get there because the numbers they contact are very high. Typically, stars, sportsmen, and politicians are there. this is the goal in an experience good is delight. How do you delight a customer? Because 50% of it is intangible, and something must be done in the intangible, not so much in the tangible. My brother was telling me, I think in one of the places he visited, if I'm not mistaken, in Sri Lanka, the promise of the place is you can touch a rainbow. It sounds like amazing, absolutely, right? And what a thing to have in a tourist destination. That's something probably we should be having, right? And then at the end of the day, just think about it, it's not a big thing. You know your physics lab, right? All you need is a prism actually to, it's not very difficult to, but to put it in a tourist destination is a brilliant idea. I think it almost brings out the child in you. That's an amazing way of delighting people and a very obvious way of actually delighting somebody. Amazing. So that's typically what happens in experience good. How do you delight somebody? Okay, there's no knowledge component in this, unlike a credence good, where the knowledge component is extremely high. For instance, look at this one. This is like super specialization kind of stuff. I don't know much about this because I'm not a doctor. And those of you who are here who probably know something about the medical field know this. It's a defect, or it's actually you can develop in your blood vessels in the brain. An aneurysm is something like that. And something like that happens, actually, you're almost sitting on a time bomb. Because if that bursts, if that swelling bursts, then that's called cerebral hemorrhage, and you'll die instantly. Right? Very, very dim. And some people might be carrying it. And I know of a colleague's niece who actually had a problem like this, and she would get serious headaches, and took them some time to diagnose this, and eventually they took them to the best doctor, a gentleman in Chitrathirunal Hospital in Trivandrum, and this guy did some 500 operations. He actually described the process, and it was, you don't want to know it, honestly. You really don't want to know what's going on there. And this man was saying, it's absolutely scary. You open the brain, that is worrying enough. Okay, and the next thing you do is the bulge is actually seared with a laser beam. Okay, and before the blood rushes out, it has to be quickly sealed. Otherwise, the patient will die in the doctor's hands. So the doctor is responsible virtually for the death. Now imagine every day a neurosurgeon does stuff like this. Just see how impossible those jobs are. I mean, how difficult those jobs are. And that's why this is the expression. You have no clue what the hell that fellow is doing. It's very difficult. In fact, you don't want to know. Many of them, they're way behind you and way beyond your comprehension. Just don't even bother, okay? And when the rational fails, then the emotional takes over, and God is not far behind. There's no other way. In fact, that's what apparently the doctor said. I have done 500 plus operations so far, which is a very big number for his age. He was a very young man at that point of time. This story was narrated to me a couple of decades back. At that point of time, he was very young, and this man said, I have done 500 operations, which is an amazing thing. He must have done it with both the hands. It's extremely difficult to have that kind of, and my run rate is extremely good, but you must understand I am not God. Okay? And he told her, told him, this man, before the girl went in, he told her, pray for me. Pray for that girl. Pray for my hands. Even the surgeon doesn't know what's going to happen when the damn thing is over. That's what credence codes are, where the knowledge component is extremely high. Ask anybody who comes to IIM, what did you learn in the 2 years here? It's a very tough thing to answer. Knowledge is like that. It's like that. You just can't put the bloody arms around the elephant. What is it? Did I learn anything? What are they doing here? Honestly, what are they doing here? So that's very difficult, in fact, to put your arms around it. And cult brand, a brand we have probably forgotten. I'll just quickly brush up this one. K. Jesus, that well-known Malayali singer, who's nationally, you know, a phenomenon. He was there from the early 60s, in all the South Indian films. He was singing here and there. He was generally hanging around, that's the word. He was generally hanging around. And his big break came when Ravindra Jain, the music director from Bollywood, noticed him. Jain is a brilliant music director, known, fairly well known. He was also a lyricist. And the breakthrough movie was a film called Chit Chor. Oh, that was a breakthrough. And we were in college at that point of time. I remember the college hostels used to, in those days, we used to have those long playing records, LPs. 24 hours just those songs were running, my God. Such a huge hit. That's all over the country. Suddenly, a man who was actually somewhere on the sidelines was shot to national fame overnight, and then a hugely successful singer in South, in North, East, West, you know it, and a man was all over the place. And from very indigenous, very, very indigent, difficult kind of circumstances, he eventually became one of the most respected, one of the most, singers, so much so that Indian Airlines, in fact, gave him the most traveled award, traveled man award. One of the, he was the most traveled by the Indian Airlines, which means he never got out of the airline. I don't know where he went and sang. This is the amazing kind of, the following he developed even today. I've heard some of this Malayalam stuff, and I know that he is the number one, number two, and number three, like Kalidasa there. There's nobody else actually after that. He's the number, that's it. All the other singers who sing like him. Almost all of them who followed him, left such an incredible imprint there. Everybody sings like him, and they sound, that is actually silly. The first thing they tell you about personal brand is, do something that's very different from others. And you'll not become another Jesus, so just one, you can't become one more. All right, and the fans were so obsessed with him that they would obviously he would go out in a car, probably ambassador car in those days, and the fans would go and kiss the impression that is made on the car tread on the road. And that's the obsession. I'm sure the same thing happens to Salman Khan or some of those fellows, and you know, all these big fellows, Beatles, Michael Jackson, whoever, all those guys actually, this is the word really is obsession. So that's the story of, so most brands start with one and then they upgrade to two and three if we are, okay. I think I'm already past my quota of time. I have just a couple of minutes. So what I'll do quickly is we'll skip through this, okay? And then I'll just go to the conclusion, which is one thing common to most personal, strong personal brands is you envy them. Most of the strong personal brands, you envy them. You emulate them. That is the life you would have lived if you were true to yourself. That's why you like them so much. This is probably what I missed, is what a strong personal brand tells you, positively or negatively. Either way, they leave an impact. Like lovers, haters, can't ignore us. That kind of, those are the brands that stand out. And they tell you every day what you probably didn't do in your life. That's what a strong personal brand does to you. It stands out, it provokes, it calls for attention, it seeks attention, and it gets attention. Thanks for the patience.
I would now like to call upon our first panelist, Mr. Abhay Nadkarni. Mr. Abhay Nadkarni is a senior management resources with skills in new business development, marketing, customer management, and general management in Fortune 500 companies. He is a bachelor in technology from IIT Bombay, 81 batch, and alumnus of IIM Bangalore, 85 batch. With over 35 years of experience, he has worked in diverse markets like Asia, Middle East, Africa, Eastern Europe, and MNCs like Unilever, J&J, and Sony. He also has considerable experience in local group entrepreneurial environment. Currently, he consults in several verticals, including emerging food, emerging technologies, and in treatment and non-communicable diseases like diabetes, hypertension. A warm welcome to you, sir. So our next panelist for the day is Mr. Aniisu K Verghesee. He is an employee communication expert, author, and a personal branding and career coach with over 20 years of experience in involving corporate communications domain with leading IT, financial services, and consulting organizations. His mission is to help organizations and individuals discover their sweet spot, though effective communication. Aniisu is passionate about helping students, practitioners, and academicians through thought leadership, content he shares on his blog, workshops he conducts for the industry, and speaking assignments on such topics as culture, social media, employee, and leadership communications. A warm welcome to you, sir. Uh,
Our next panelist is Ms. Monika. Monika is an alumnus of IIMB from the PTP 2000 batch. She has learned branding while working with organizations across the spectrum, large multinationals to seed funded startups of small NGOs. She has developed strategies for product, service, and company brands. She has studied branding in villages in Bihar and London high streets. She co-founded a brand and social impact consulting firm, Hire at Work. A warm welcome to you, ma'am. So our last panelist is Mr. Aakarsh Naidu. He's an alumnus of the London School of Economics, startup ecosystem enabler, and a founder of the Startupreneur. He has been initiative at one of the India's top startup incubators, NSRCL, at IIMB, following the great response for his the startup video on the social media. Aakarsh has also featured in the startup video series of the Startupreneur and has more recently written a song and performed the startup song. He has been covered in various national and international media outlets. A warm welcome to you, sir.
Doing the honors today, and it's an excellent panel, which actually covers almost everything you want to know about personal branding. And so we'll start with Abhay, and then we'll take it further. Let's quickly, I want to panel to, so the way we'll go is this, we'll take about an hour, or maybe max hour, 1 hour, 5 minutes, or 10 minutes of discussion, followed by 15, 20 minutes of questions. So by 12:30, we must be able to round up. Right, you're able to hear me? Yeah, okay. Yes, sir, question to you, Abhay, and then we pass on in the sequence. How does one create a personal brand? You were with Levers and for several years, and so maybe you can tell us how this can be done. Yep.
Okay, so firstly, the assumption I'm going to make is that since most of our audience is from the corporate sector, we would look at the creation of a personal brand in the corporate context. Yeah. So we looked at, during professor's presentation, at super brands or super personal brands. But every one of you can have a personal brand. And therefore, every one of you should, as you do career progression or business progression, look at consciously creating a personal brand for yourself, because it has a multiplier effect on whatever professional activity that you do. Now, the most important aspect of the personal brand is not what you say you are, but it is what people perceive you to be. So the whole issue is about how do I manage perception of what people think I am. Now, if you try and fake it, it's not going to work in the long run. So that's not one way to go. But sorry, let me just look at my cock sheet. I don't know how many of you are here. But you know, the first question you have to ask is, do I have a personal brand at all? Or are you a mishmash of mixed messages that different people have about you? So you need to first have a focused impression that most people have about you. Yeah. So that's the first thing. The second thing is, before you start creating yourself a personal brand, there are some questions that you need to ask yourself, which is very, very critical for you. And the five introspective questions that you have to ask yourself is, what do I want people to think of me as? Yeah. How do I be that person? How do I package myself so people think of me that way? And then, obviously, you got to keep going around with feedback and say, am I getting there, or how do I reinvent myself? Now, these are the first primary questions that you have to ask yourself before you can start saying, okay, now I'm going to start creating my brand. And then deciding what my personal brand should stand for is the next step. And the first thing that you have to do is to have some clarity of purpose and write out what I call a personal charter. And this is a personal charter in the professional context or the corporate context. So what are my internal goals, routes, targets, purpose? What am I trying to achieve? Where am I trying to get to professionally? What are the likely paths to that goal? What do I need to professionally do to reach that goal on merit? Yeah, to professionally deserve that goal. What soft and hard skills and personality traits do I need to have in order to reach that goal? And can I acquire them? So that's on the personal front. The second is, who am I talking to? So who are my primary and secondary influencers to reach my goal? Now, just to give you a goal, suppose, let us say, you are working in a consumer products company or in a bank, and you join as a management trainee, and you say, in 5 years or 10 years, I want to be a VP. If you want to be a VP in 5 years, the starting point for that is, what is required of me in order for me to be considered for a VP position? And then how do I get people to perceive that I have all those qualities?
Abhay, can I? I think we'll make the initial comments brief and then keep moving. Any quick things, one or two things you want to say?
Yeah, just two or three things that I would like to talk about is, there's a lot of introspection that you have to do and a lot of understanding what makes and creates a personal brand that first you need to consider before you get into the various steps of creating a brand.
Yeah, great. You can pass the mic. Sir, request the panel members to be brief, so because there are lots of interesting questions and maybe there's also an audience round. So if you're brief, then I think we can discuss lots of questions. Yes, sir.
Okay, good morning, everyone. Thank you for inviting me, Professor. The way I would begin by just defining how I think personal branding is, and I think it is the way of differentiating yourself by adding value to others. Now that might sound a bit odd because people usually think, oh, it should be about me, but it's really not about you, it's about others. So there is, based on, I've read a bit of research, I've looked up how others have done their journeys, and I've put together a model, and this is freely available on the net, anyone can use this, and I'll explain what the model is. It's called the 3C model. First C is clarity, commitment, and consistency. So these are the 3 C's of how you can build a personal brand, and that's just one layer of it. The other layer is about, you first build expertise, and that's the strategy you take. So unless you are an expert, no one's really going to see value in which you can add. So the second is, how do you add value? And the third is, how do you reinvent yourself? So all this is really underpinned by communication. So that's really what the model tells. And of course, this is not something which can be done overnight. Personal branding takes time. And there's a very interesting Chinese proverb which says, the best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago. And the second best time is now, which means that you still have time to build your personal brand. It's not, you know, you don't need to despair about that, but it's always good to start thinking about it. So those are my initial thoughts, and I'll pass it on.
Hello, everyone. When Ankita first called me for this panel, I said, but I don't actively create my personal brand, so how can I speak about it? Then Partha called me and he said, okay, you've done product and organization branding. So we just want that perspective. So I said, okay, fine. We'll talk about that because personal branding is something I always thought, how do you live according to a concept that you want to create of yourself? Then I remembered my first boss in branding when I started and when we were working for a large multinational that time. And he taught us then that your brand gets created anyhow, whether you do anything or not, whether you say anything or not. So you might as well do it consciously. So I think that's where personal branding comes into play. But I mean, increasingly, as I have worked with brands for now 20 years on the ground, everywhere, I feel increasingly the relevance aspect that the professor was talking about is becoming much more important than differentiation. And why I say that is now because there's so much around you. There are so many brands, there are so many people doing what you are doing. So how will you differentiate? You will differentiate by 0.02 microns, or you have a bigger nose and he has a smaller nose? What is the differentiation? Because you may have gone to the same colleges, you may have done the same things. So then you have to be very, very relevant to who you want to serve. And to do that, first thing is you have to understand them. So I was in Goa last weekend. I was running a workshop for them. And I said the most important thing in branding is empathy. And there was a blank look. There were 80 participants. And there was a blank look because also youngsters, how do you talk empathy? But if you really understand your audience very well, like you understand your family members, you know exactly how to serve them the best way. And if you do it consistently over a long time, you gain a reputation for doing it well. And then more and more people seek you. And then you talk about it. But if you start talking about it without doing anything, then you just fall flat. So that's my take on personal branding. I'll leave it to the panel.
Thank you. So first of all, thank you, Professor, and the alumni department for inviting, because the fact that I'm sitting here speaking on a personal branding subject, IIMB has a lot of significance and relevance to that, because it is this platform which has kind of laid the foundation for me to start developing a personal brand. So first of all, I'm humbled by this opportunity, and also want to put it on record that this has been the starting point for my journey as building a personal brand. Now, coming to what is a personal brand, very quickly, I think it is authenticity that matters the most, because pretty much all of us have a certain value system about how we approach life, how we do certain things or don't do certain things, and that becomes a reflection. So personal brand is nothing but a projection of who you are as a person at a bigger scale. So coming to that, there were three or four kind of rules that I figured out through the process of building a personal brand. Again, you know, I feel a bit a little shy to say that I'm trying to build a personal brand or whatever, but the intent is like there are three or four things. So the first aspect that I learned is it's really important for you to recognize your strengths. So what is it that you're really known for? What is it that you're good at or great at, and how can you project that? The second thing is acknowledge your weaknesses. I think that is really important, because everyone can't do everything, and every brand has its set of limitations. So it is really important for you to acknowledge that early on, so that you know the domain or the niche that you're catering to. The other aspect that I feel, other two aspects which are important in shaping a personal brand or defining a personal brand are, you need to be very clear about what you want to do, and more clear about what you don't want to do. And I think that is, these are some of the basic guidelines that I have followed. It is a difficult kind of process, because there is temptation. If you're on LinkedIn, there are these influencers who are coming up, and you know, everyone does have a certain way of approaching things. You may want to kind of see how the others are doing it and pick it up, but it's really, really important to keep your own, like, you know, something that stands out, and then grow your brand. And final point I would like to make on this is it takes time. It takes a few years easily for people to start perceiving you in the domain that you're known for. In fact, the whole my association with the startup ecosystem or the startup world in general began with me getting associated with NSRCL, which is the startup incubator here. And from there on, I spent a few years interacting with various stakeholders, building an offline connection with the startup community, and eventually that translating into social media through an online, through videos and other aspects. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Quick roundup. What he was saying, he was kind of giving you a charter of how to do it. If you look at what Abhay said, and Mr. Aniisu was actually telling you, he advises clients on how to build a personal brand. So I think we'll go for that a little later. Monika made two very interesting points. The first thing is the other guys will make a brand out of you one way or the other, good or bad reasons. And the most interesting thing is she said was, first start living your brand. I mean, yeah, then start doing. I mean, then start going on your, that's a chicken egg kind of a problem. Do you promote the product or do you build the product first? So that's the She's very right. Without the product being ready, there's no point in promoting it. That's the point she's making. And Varun was telling you the challenges of being a, Aakarsh was telling you the challenge of being a CEO. And we'll probably go there. That question also is there. And the at least thrice he repeated this, that what you don't do is more important. This is especially important for CEOs and also for startups, because the CEO is everything, from the clerk to the startups, that way, that guy does everything. So if you don't know what you want to do and what you want to delegate, I think you'll end up doing so many things that your bandwidth will be completely exhausted. Some very interesting set of things we heard. So let's go to each of our panel members and learn something. Sir, what are the tips you give to Verghese? What are the tips you give to your, tell us three, four things that you tell clients when you say somebody wants to build a personal brand, what would that be?
So the first step which I tell them is it's a marathon, it's not a sprint, which means that if you are in this for the short term, then it's definitely not going to work out. So think about, again, going by what some of the panelists said, who you are, what you stand for. And
what do you think is the first thing I should do if I want to become a personal brand?
So first step, like I said, in my model, which I defined, you need to build expertise. So you need to be an expert in a domain. So the world is going towards specialization. There is so many trends which tell you that if you are not an expert, and Dr. Moorthi also spoke about, doctors, specialization in that. Everywhere, people really want experts. And of course, you can be a generalist, it's great, but unless you are a domain expert in one area, no one's really going to take you seriously. And you would not be able to add value to others because they won't really see you as credible, as authentic. So that's really the first step. And of course, it's in the long term, you need to stay committed to who, what you're doing. And, panelists said, there'll be so many distractions. And how you keep yourself focused and stick to what you're trying to do, irrespective of everything that's coming your way, is also very important.
Great. Monika, any ideas on this? Because you have been with the corporate world for a very long time. So anything you want to say?
Yeah, when I think of brand, the word that comes to my mind is always value. So what is the value that the brand is creating in people's lives? So rather than having an inside-out approach all the time, I feel an outside-in approach is very useful. I'll just tell you one story briefly. This was in a village in Punjab. I was working on a brand strategy for a leading paints company. And that I was working on that brand, which is an economy brand. So I was talking to one housewife. She had three or four children. Husband was a laborer. She had a broken home, kacha home, not pakka. And she used to paint every year. And this was an economy brand, so the company thought of it as an economy brand, that we are giving an affordable range of products. So I was speaking to her, and she was talking about her hardships, that how much she doesn't have the money. So I said, then how do you paint every year? And she said, I'll never forget that. That's a branding lesson for me. She said, we don't have vegetables for 1 month. We forego vegetables for 1 month, and that's how we paint. So I went back to the client and I said, you may think of it as an economy product, but for the person who's consuming it, it's a super luxury product. So and then the codes that you have of packaging, of communication, everything has to be a super luxury code, not an economy code. So rather than saying what I want to be, an introspection of who am I, like panelists have said, and who can I create the value for? We start there. If that's the starting point, then we can build on it.
Abhay, any thoughts?
I fully agree with both of them. One is in terms of value creation that she talked about. Now, that is probably the number one thing that people should look at in their personal brand. Can you imagine Virat Kohli as a personal brand without his cricket, or Sachin Tendulkar, or David Beckham without football? So to create a personal brand, the first thing is you got to be very good at something, what he called domain specialist. And you can't fake it. And you know, you have to have increased levels of proficiency as you go through your career. And that's the starting point. And most importantly, no matter how good you are, the personal brand is about what people think you are and how good you are. So it is about the perception of tangible value creation. How do people perceive you in terms of the value that you create for your organization, for your group, for your team, for your department, whatever?
Quick interjection here. Is value always tangible?
In the corporate context, tangible is not necessarily in terms of numbers or specific delivery.
I thought that's what corporate was all about. Ask her, ask him.
But
I thought that's what they drive you down.
Now,
to
you know, I'll give you an example of tangible value creation that's not in numbers. The ability to handle complexity is a tangible value that, or is a specific expertise that an individual can have. And then what happens is you have a subsidiary company, complete mess, too much complexity. They want somebody to go and sort the mess out. They say, why don't you look at this guy? He can handle the complexity. Send him as the CEO. So it's about what people perceive you are able to do. Yeah?
So okay. Yeah. Okay. Anything more?
Well, I have quite a few things which nobody seems to have touched on. We can touch it over on it later.
Right. Maybe quickly.
A quick one is, what do you guys think about the following people's personal brands? Vijay Mallya, Ramalinga Raju, P. Chidambaram and Lalu Yadav, Chanda Kochar, Rajat Gupta. Right? Something went wrong. And that's where a very important aspect of the personal brand comes in. It's what people perceive your personal value system to be. And it's very critical. And your personal value system is related to how you conduct yourself and how people perceive you when they interact with you. I have other points, but.
Right, yeah, yeah.
So I'll just, you know, quickly in a couple of minutes, I'll start with a quote that I'd seen somewhere at a co-working space. So it says that 0.99 to the power of 365 is less than 1. 1 to the power of 365 is perhaps equal to 1. And 1.01 to the power of 365 is a lot more. It comes to 13 or 14, something like that. So here, I think in personal brand, it's really important for you to go the extra mile when it comes to projecting what you do. I would like to add on from all what the other panelists have said about value creation and showcasing your domain expertise. I'll share my own experiences of how, A, I was perceived as a domain expert or someone who could talk about startups, and how I have projected it that has led to the so-called creation of a personal brand. So I think today I can ask or tell any one of you, you can actually Google my name, Aakarsh Naidu, and you will have at least 6 or 7 pages of content which flows into it. But this hasn't happened overnight. It led to a certain projection of whatever I do to the you know, people around me. So few of the channels that you could use to showcase your expertise are, of course, LinkedIn. The articles, you know, give you a certain level of thought leadership. It doesn't come immediately, but over a period of time, people start picking up your content, and it gets circulated in the community. So LinkedIn, Medium are places where you can start showcasing your thought leadership. YouTube, you may not get immediate viewership, but what it does is, you know, you get optimized on Google. You know, I'm just giving you a hack where, you know, if you have a video on YouTube and when people search for you with your name, your video shows up. So that comes up in the first page of Google as well. So these are little things that you discover over a period of time, but also it's an articulation of who you are. Like, you know, your first page of Google should be able to tell you what this guy does. And, you know, and for that matter, if you have your LinkedIn page optimized as a quick summary of a paragraph or two, and when people search for you, okay, this person is working with HP or so and so in this, you know, X years of expertise, but little more on what is it that you have done beyond the job is what would add that X factor. I mean, I'll go on with more hacks later in the in the conversation, but yeah, I'll stop here for now.
Right, and I think what he's saying is, once the dish is ready, how do you tell people about what the dish is? But I think the more interesting thing is what some of the other panel members have done, or said, which is getting the dish ready in the first place, which is, are you ready really? You are broadcasting about yourself, fine, but who are you? Do you really have the ability to broadcast about yourself? Do you have the stuff for that? And one of the things that's actually happening in now is, I think we are going out and saying a whole lot of things without being ready ourselves. And that goes by the name of WhatsApp University. I think quite a few of not only getting degrees from that, we are graduating, and I think we are also celebrating that graduation, which basically means number of hits and so on. I suppose that's important in a 2-minute Maggie kind of a world that we live in. I'm sure that's but the problem in approach, and that's really, really the worry that we're having right now, that our attention span is so low now that it's actually becoming extremely difficult for us to develop any expertise. In fact, I'm very glad I was brought up in an era when none of this nonsense was there. And the reason for that was very simply this: it's a great way to communicate, and nobody is actually denying that. The problem really is, what will you serve when the dish is not ready? That's the problem we're actually facing now. And a whole lot of us want to speak about what? Have you thought about it? That, getting that organized. In fact, somebody was telling me that this gentleman is a trainer, like some of our friends here, and he was saying that, chief, if it's a one-day kind of a workshop, I just walk in. I mean, you can blah, 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 because you have a day. These half an hour speeches are very, very difficult. The one that I was asked to do, I had 4 slides, as you must have seen, and I produced it big time. I could do 3. That's the way it is. Very, very, it's hit and run. It's very, very difficult. And when you're going into a public space, and there are thousands and thousands of videos in the world, the first thing that when you ask somebody, which is the biggest nation in the world, the answer is China. Try the answer Facebook. Yeah, the more people digitally connected there. I mean, what makes you think a nation has to be geographically the same? Yeah, I mean, we are in a different digital world, right? And there are some people who are the so-called millennials, who were born after the internet revolution, who are residents of the digital world, and there are people like me who are migrants into that world. And very clearly the difference is, and I can't even book an Ola without them messing it up. And that fellow doesn't allow you any other way of booking. There's no other way of reaching that guy also, right? So that's the kind of difficult world some of us are walking into. So that part, I think this is really the thing. One of the things I would like to caution, and I shouldn't be exhausting their time and text, and I'll bring it back to the panel members, is, I think, first get yourself ready. And as a very well-known stockbroker once said, get the bride ready first, okay? Get her educated, get her groomed, send her to a finishing school, there will be suitors, don't worry. Okay, first get the kitchen right, get the cook organized, get the dish organized. I'm sure we'll go to town and talk about it, but we should know what we should talk about. Thought that would be a kind of dose of caution before we go. And then I would start with each of you. Maybe Abhay, you can start. I want each of you to tell us a couple of, because strong personal brands impact you for good or bad. Right. I want you to tell one or two brands that are very interesting personally, that you thought were very interesting positively, and one or two which are very interesting negatively, which basically means how they impact you and how probably we should stay away from some of those, because that's how you'll get known if you follow some of those tracks. Yes, sir. We'll start with you and quickly move to the others. Yeah.
So I'll start with one brand which probably everybody in the room is familiar with, Nandan Nilekani. What is the brand essence of Nandan Nilekani? IT industry leadership, founder of an investor-centric ethical company, and you talked about it, about not bribing people, and they hold that value extremely strong and very, very high, and they are investor-centric because they give 70 or 80% of what they earn back to the investors. Now, the value system was set by seven people. That value system continues. Nandan, the core team in that team was Narayan Murthy, Nandan, and Chris Gopalakrishnan. And they actually created the value system of this company. And, you know, he has lived that. What Narayan Murthy has said about Nandan in public forums is that he is able to build consensus. And a classic case of this was when he was able to continue the UIDAI initiative of Aadhaar, even though the government changed from the UPA to the NDA, by building consensus around it. There was a time when he was within the UPA government and P. Chidambaram was having doubts about the Aadhaar initiative completely, and he bent around and built that, got everybody rallied around. So he is a builder of consensus, which is another strong entity about his brand. Philanthropy, he is very, very big in philanthropy. He has given away half his wealth. He's worth close to $2 billion. He has pledged half his wealth to charity in the presence of the Microsoft chairman. And the other is thought leadership. Now, that's the essence of Nandan Nilekani. And that, I think, is a super brand.
Sure. Yes, sir.
So to me, the one name which comes out is Harish Bijur. So he's a brand consultant. And again, if I refer back to the model which I talked about, building expertise, adding value, and reinventing yourself. So if you look at what Harish has done, he obviously worked in the corporate world for a couple of decades before he became a consultant. And he's holding a record for about 11,000 plus hours of speeches or workshops which he's done for the corporate world. Now, I can reflect on this before. There's an interesting book by Malcolm Gladwell called Outliers, where he talks about 10,000 hours of practice or deliberate practice, which makes you an expert. Now, obviously, it's very clear that Harish has put in that much time. And now he has reinvented himself as a consultant, and he's an author, he does research, and all kinds of stuff. So, very interesting example. The other example I can talk about is a small girl called Praniti Kumar. I don't know how many of you all have heard of her. She's just 10 years old now, and she's a playback singer for the Tamil industry and movies. Obviously, she started singing at the age of 5 or something, younger than that. But she's like a sensation. She's got her own YouTube channel. Her videos go viral. And of course, I'm sure her parents are shepherding her through this journey, but she is a personal brand. So it doesn't matter which age you are at. I mean, you can still build a personal brand, is what I'm trying to say. And of course, there are other examples, like there's Marshall Goldsmith, who's a famous leadership coach. Again, one word which comes to my mind is humility. He's absolutely humble. He's done amazing amount of work. He doesn't really need to be doing what he's doing, but he's absolutely always giving back to the world around him through his coaching talks, through his books, through his webinars, podcasts. Yeah, so these are some of the examples I had.
So yesterday I was with a group of women and men from the Bangalore slums. We were working for a bank brand, and they want to launch a product for this segment. And the prerequisite was that they had to come from that Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana accounts. So when we started talking to them, we asked them what accounts you have. All of them said Modi account. So so clearly, a lot of what the panelists have been saying, the steps to follow to build a brand, has happened. And I just go back to what Professor was talking about cult branding. There's a very beautiful book called How to Build an Iconic Brand. And what it says is that iconic brands get built when a brand comes and assuages the deepest anxieties and desires of a nation or of a group. So there is some prevalent anxiety or a desire that whole group community has, and it's not being fulfilled. And a brand comes, like Nike comes with Just Do It, or Apple comes with its 1984 advertisement of breaking that IBM mainframe, like taking on the big guy. So somehow it has happened in this case. And you get a small group of insiders who buy into it. then you get a set of followers, then it becomes mass. So it, you can see that in action happen very beautifully over the years, and it is a mass brand now. And we will see it also in personal examples. I see it all the time in the organizations that I work with. So if there is a prevalent anxiety in the organization that they can't come to terms with, grapple with, for example, I will say, AI is not an example, but a lot of IT firms, when they were struggling, AI was coming in, the fear of being left behind. If, as an individual, you are able to come and offer them a solution to that, bring that necessary skills or show them a way out of it and project yourself at that, you become kind of like a cult brand within the organization. So yeah, it is possible to do, but yeah, it again comes back to what I've been saying fundamentally, understand your audience, and then perhaps you can create you. And then live your life. We can't live our life to A plus B plus 2. That's not the way we live. We are many more things. But yeah, we can make some attempts to communicate and reach out about who we are and how we can deliver value.
So I'll take two examples from the film industry itself, because that's something which I follow very closely. So, I'll give you two examples of brands, one in the cult branding itself. So let us take the examples of the Khans, or whatever, the Shah Rukh, Salman Khan, and maybe Rajnikant, and the so-called cult brands. There is a concept of brand loyalty. If you see all these actors, they are known to give or deliver on a certain kind of genre of films, and they are known to give a certain kind of performance. Anything that they do outside their norm is always a risk. So this is a two-sided, it's a double-edged sword, that on one hand you have a certain kind of following that, worships you and all of that, but on the other hand it becomes difficult for you to experiment after a point. So this is one kind of a challenge in personal branding. I'll give you another example within the film industry, Ranveer Singh. He's come up in recent times, and he does, every film is very different from the other. So if he does, Padmavat, and then where he plays Khilji, and then he plays this inspector in Simba, and now he's playing Kapil Dev in 83. He's been able to create that niche where he's also able to experiment with a lot of variety, as well as be seen as someone who delivers on quality content. So these are kind of some of the pointers to be kept in mind, that what your audience is like. I mean, of course, you may be well known or well connected within your network, and what is the expectation of that network from you, and how is it that you deliver to that becomes the conversation that you have in your personal brand story.
Great, sir. See, quickly I'll run through what our friends have said. Since this is quasi-academic, there's an interesting book called Men of Steel, written by a guy called Veer Sanghvi. Yeah, same name that you're thinking of. Veer Sanghvi, V-I-R-S-A-N-G-H-V-I. In which he picks up 10 people on whom he says, this was written about 10 years ago, or maybe more, in which he says, I am betting on these people, okay? And these people will hold the key for the next century. Some of the pins fell by the wayside, like Vijay Mallya and so on. But one of the names he mentioned was Nandan Nilekani, and I know people who personally worked with Nandan from my batch. I mean, a remarkable leader, I was told. And in a crowd of 10,000, we can pick up one person and, hey, how are you? I read the book you gave me. That kind of that connect, he has an amazing ability absolutely to connect. I was impressed. Lots of people told me interesting stuff about, and the transition from a politician to Aadhaar and so on. Like an Amitabh Bachchan who reinvented himself again and again, went into a trough and came back every time. And today he's unstoppable at 77. What is he now? Amitabh Bachchan. I don't think any of the youngsters can, he can give all these youngsters a run for their money even today. He stands there, he stands tall. Look at that KBC that he did. I don't think anybody was successful in doing it after him. A dozen fellows tried to the extent I know, all of them bumped. I don't even want to name the names, and some of them are very big. He humbled some of the biggest actually there, and he did nothing. He was being his own good self. The other thing he was talking about was the 10,000 hours, barrier that you have to. This is from a book called Outliers. Yeah, that's a forget the author's name. It's a very fair look. Yeah, yeah, that's a fairly well-known book. And he says, one of the things he says is, you have to cross that. If you really want to, yahan dhakkan khulna hai, to, you know, yeah. So I think it's a very good idea. Before you go to YouTube, work for at least 1,000 hours. Yeah, yeah. Then yeah, we can broadcast about ourselves, because that's the hurry we seem to be in. Yeah, yeah. All dressed and nowhere to go. That might actually happen if you really are not prepared for the story. I know Harish very well. In fact, he wrote the foreword for my first book. When I invited him here, I remember that distinctly for one of the classes here. I usually have a backup plan. Always have a plan B. That's true for most things in life, and certainly for guest lectures, because like he was saying, Abhay was saying, there are actually guys who rang me up and say, sorry chief, I can't come, I'm in Dubai. What? You said you'd be here this morning. I said, yeah, there was a, you know, investor meeting. You know, they can't do anything. He said, you have no book of your own, right? It's just the client's book. The fellow calls you, if some Larry Ellison summons you, if you're in Oracle, what will you do? You jolly well go there. That's the problem, you know, you just don't have a calendar. Many of those calendars get upset, many of the. So I was actually holding fort in the classroom till I came. He was something like 20, 25 minutes late. And this was courtesy Banerghatta Road. This was even before the metro started, so you can imagine what it is now. So this is like, you know, you start here and you want to go to the airport, it's like half day CL, casually. I mean, you can forget it. I mean, so that's the that's the story on that. And I think one of the things that maybe we can spend, and I want the panelists to briefly tell me. Some of these guys have something in their DNA that makes them different. Now, I want you to tell us about one brand maybe, which really struggled and got there. I mean, that's really the model we have to put, because we just don't know the starting point, where we are and so on. And on. Will I get there? Will I really become a great brand, et cetera, et cetera. I think sheer struggle and somebody gets there. Overpowering all sorts of difficulties. Some brands like that, I would want each one of you to name one which you can think, if you can. Abhay will start with you. Somebody who really struggled. Let me give you one example of at least one I remember. Venkatraman Ramakrishnan, this man who won the Nobel Prize a few years back for his work in genetics, basically. It was an interface of chemistry, biology. I don't know under what heading he got the Nobel Prize, but an amazing struggle of how he's. NDTV, in fact, invited him. As usual, Indians suddenly wake up to great guys once they get Nobel Prizes, and they do well in US, and some of we never look at great guys in this country. There are many. It's a pity. But then our friend came, it was very nice. And he actually told us the steps he went through. It was amazing. I don't want to take the time of the panel. Let's get it from them first. Yeah, and I'll give each one of them a brief while. Sir Abhay, I can start with you. Go ahead. Can you think of somebody who, you know, who really struggled and got there, you know, and became a brand eventually over a period of time?
So there are quite a few examples of people who become big brands posthumously. So Ramanujam is a very good example of that. Struggled in his life, became famous, and became a brand later. But if we have to look at real life brands today, one of the brands that I have worked with, who I was absolutely fascinated with, is the founder and chairman of this large education NGO called Prathamam. I don't know if people have heard of. His name is Madhav Chauhan. PhD in chemistry from the United States, came back and decided to give back to society, and started very small with street children in Bombay. And, you know, social entrepreneurs require absolutely, they need nerves of steel to succeed, because everything is stacked against them. It's a real, real struggle. Nobody wants to give money. There are vested interests in the local slums. There are threats. There is threat to life. Many kinds of things. And through all that, they finally built an organization that was reaching out to more than 1 million kids a year. 1 million kids a year. And then they were funded by the who's who of industry. Their board had the Ambanis and the Piramals, and you know, their chairman was N. Vagul, who was chairman of ICICI Bank, and at that time Rajat Gupta was the global head of McKinsey. He was on the board. They took it to that level, and finally when they are the ones who initiated ASSER, and they were the ones who started the data gathering of ASSER, which is the National Survey on Education and State of the Nation on Education, was initiated by Pratham, and he was on the board of advisors for education to Sonia Gandhi. So I think this is a classic case of a brand that has
struggles and gets there. Yeah.
Okay, one name which comes to my mind, and again, not many of you may know this name, but there's a famous tennis player called Thomas Muster, and again, this is in the 80s, late 80s, so those who follow tennis will know he's you know, Australian tennis player. But, you know, he was world number one at one stage, and then I believe, you know, he had a bad accident where his leg was badly injured and bruised, and for a tennis player, that's like a disaster, and he kind of then recovered, you know, went into rehabilitation, came out of course, you know, tennis players go into depression if things like this go wrong, and then came back very strongly and became again number one. And he was a clay court specialist, again going back to, you know, the specialization. He was a clay court specialist. He used to win almost every single clay court tournament in the world, and he used to lose badly in the grass and other you know, formats, but clay was his specialty. So, I mean, I used to really look up to a player like that, someone who's so determined, so committed, would just kind of train really hard to get where he was. And then the other part, of course, was that he was always giving back to the community through his foundation and other things, which also made me feel, yes, he's got more than just tennis. He's also a holistic, you know, holistically developed person. So that's the example I had.
Personalities like Steve Jobs, who start off in a garage, but this is like American middle class, so it can be super rich here. But the key thing about him was there was a lot of introspection of who he was, and you know, all his thing of coming to India and trying to find out who you are and what he wanted to offer to the world. And holding on steadfast to that, he struggled a lot through it all, but he remained true to what he wanted to offer to the world. But in my work, I constantly see, I mean, they need not be larger than life brands. You know, at community level, there are so many people who struggle every day, and then they create a reputation by doing something and by offering something of value. Earlier, a few months back, I met a girl in Hyderabad. I was working for an NGO which works with livelihoods for the disabled, persons with a disability. She was abandoned at birth, this girl, and she was severely disabled. She was adopted. She was picked up from the hospital, and she was adopted. And then the person who adopted her died. So she was left at the mercy of the family members, where she didn't receive the same level of welcome that the person who adopted her had given her. But if you met her, you should have seen the glow on her face. She fought through for 30 years. Right now, she's working in JP Morgan. She has a company, like even the company bus coming to pick her up is such a big deal in the neighborhood, and she has just inspired a whole community of persons with disability to dream big. And she has got the reputation of really overcoming everything to achieve something in life. And this is constant. This is, of course, an NGO example, but constantly across brands, when you go and meet people, there are many stories in India. So really, the inspiration can come from anywhere.
Thanks to all the panelists, they brought some stories of brands which are not fairly known in the mainstream. I would like to take an example of a very mainstream brand, one that you and I know. This brand is called Modi. He's the one, you know, people have strong opinions about him either ways. That's how he's built his brand. But I feel he is one of those people who really struggled or worked his way to build the brand, because you know, coming from Gujarat, he was just one of the party workers. He built, he rose up the ranks. And, you know, there was a time when US had rejected his visa because of the, you know, certain allegations being upon him. Today he is, you know, shaking hands with the president there, and you know, he gets a, you know, red carpet welcome where he goes, and also, you know, the whole brand, it was just fairly state limited, so only Gujarat used to recognize this particular brand. But now he really put himself and he created a machinery around it, where whatever he says became a statement. Like it, he created a story around himself, the whole Chaiwala, you know, pitch that he had, and then you know, recently maybe Chowkidar and all of that. So it came to a point where whatever he said became so-called viral, or you know, it became more mainstream. But then it was not an overnight journey. Usually the perception associated with a particular brand is it happens in youth or maybe in the earlier part of the years. But today, if you hear the word Modi, he's, I don't know, 60 plus something. So the brand became really popular post the age of 60. So it shows that maybe 30, 40 years of work that he's put in till date, that has come to this stage. So, you know, that reinforces every the point that there is no age for branding. It's just that you need to start the journey and you will eventually get there. Yeah.
A quick thing, though. I wanted to say something about the brands they mentioned. I think I should allow the panelists to speak, so I don't think I want to intervene there. I want a quick intervention from each of the panelists. Just one or two lines on how you built your brand, each of you. That would be interesting because we have you in person here, so maybe we can start with you, sir, and you go down quickly. Yeah.
Yes, sir. So I'll take maybe 2 minutes, but I have to explain the chronology so that you understand how this personal brand got built. I have, you know, fortunately been educated in some of the known educational institutions. So I studied at Hyderabad Public School, then Christ College, and then went to London School of Economics for my master's. And my associations post that have been with premier institutions as well. So I worked as a research associate with Indian School of Business, and more recently with IIM Bangalore. So I was in charge of the startup initiatives here at the startup incubator. So if you see the chronology of brands, there have been a certain brands that I kind of worked with, but also projecting that into the next level was a real challenge for me, because I was, you know, as a startup ecosystem enabler, I was known for someone who was from NSRCL or IIM Bangalore. How is it that I branch out from an institution so huge and create your own niche that stands out irrespective of what brands you belong to? So that was a challenge. And I was thinking about it, and that's when I came up with this whole Startupreneur video series. That was my opportunity of showcasing something that was of my interest, like creating videos, showcasing it out there. So I did something called as a startup video while I was in IIM Bangalore. So that reached about you know, few lakhs of people, like they saw about startups. And eventually this whole Startupreneur video series, which was post my stint with IIMB. So that reached a wide audience. It had gone to a point where people from Bhutan had invited me to speak to the entrepreneurs, because a lot of them watched my videos there, which I really didn't know. And more recently, there's the startup song that I had written and sung. One of the startups told me that my three-year-old is singing startup, startup, startup after listening to your song. These are the things that kind of validate what the work that you're doing. And also, I just got sidetracked. But the point is, it takes that effort. So this is 3 or 4 years down the line that I'm today able to talk about a personal brand. And it's important to A, have a certain niche or something special about your particular brand, or what is your story that is very different from any others. And then how do you project that in a much more scalable way? Yeah, thanks.
So for a person who's worked with branding all her life, I was always very against personal branding. So, my mantra was just find your mojo. I'll find my mojo and I'll just work. And if I do great work, more work will come and I'll live my life like that. And it still is, broadly is. But the penny really dropped when I started my firm Hire at Work. I started it with a colleague. She's also a woman. So And luckily, because I worked with many clients, they call me. So we need some. So this is a large multinational, one of the biggest in Europe. And so India, they wanted to do the retail branding, called me. So everything went through. Now, I'm sorry if anyone is from finance. But so then the finance team wanted to have the final discussion. Obviously, money is there, so they wanted to put their weight. And this gentleman is telling me, he's negotiating me. I said, why are you negotiating? All that negotiation is already done. You're supposed to just pass the purchase order. He's saying, you are two women who have just started one firm, and you are working for such a big brand, and you don't think you should give some discount. So I said, no, why should no? So that you can get more. No one knows you. And the penny really dropped at that moment, that while the people know you, who know you, will know your value, but there is perhaps some value in talk. And that is after a lot of work. Like, we now have a lot of things to say. So possibly then we start writing, we're putting out papers. But it's just a question of formulating your thoughts and putting it out there. So minimally, that's what we do.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so my journey, in fact, started. I started my career in advertising, and I can say that, you know, I was always passionate about communication, even through school. I used to be part of the college newsletter. I used to be part of the editorial board. So there was that inherent idea in me that I would specialize in communications. And so when I started my career in advertising, then I found my, you know, mojo, like, so to speak, in employee communications. In those days, when I started my career, it's a very nascent subject in India, even now. Those days, people used to say, you're making a mistake getting into internal communications, public relations pays more, event management pays more, go into that area. And I said, no, I mean, this is what I'm really passionate about, and I'll continue in this space, even though if I don't get paid more, that's fine. And so for the next 15 years, I just did that, just continuing to focus on employee communication. And how I went about it was, I started a blog of my own in 2006, and my commitment was every week I'll put out one post about employee communications. And it's really from everyday experience, what I see, what happens in the workplace, what are the trends around me. And over time, people started noticing it, not just in India, but abroad, UK, US, and other places. And I used to start getting emails saying, okay, can you talk more about this? And then Sage Publications reached out to me in 2008 or 9, saying, can you author a book on the subject? I was like petrified, saying, I can't, because I just started writing about this topic, so give me some time. And after about 4 or 5 years, I put together a book, and in 2012, I authored a book. And this is a book I authored. This is probably the only book on the subject in the country at this stage, is what I can consider. I used to also teach at a few B schools. So again, students used to walk up to me and say, you know, what is internal communications? Can you tell me about it? And I realized there was a huge opportunity to even talk about it and write about it. So I put all that together. I continue to still write. So from 2006 to now, my blog continues one post a week. In fact, yesterday was my other post for this week. And then I speak at B schools, I conduct workshops, I train. So again, all this again around employee communications. And what also it helped validate was that people used to reach out to me, and all my jobs which I have got in the last three, you know, attempts has been through referrals on LinkedIn, people, consultants reaching out saying, you're an expert in this domain, we'd like to hire you. And that really validated the importance of what you have done over time.
Great, sir. Yeah. Quickly, Abhay.
Yeah. So, as you can tell by the color of my hair, my career has been pretty long. When I started out, there was no internet. The concept of personal branding, which were Tom Peters coined, was 15 years later. So the initial part of my career was without any concept of personal branding. The only thing that drove us was professional progression and career progression. So I'm just going to share with you the milestones in terms of what decisions I took in that period. So we didn't have any blogs, we didn't have LinkedIn, at least till 1995, there was no LinkedIn. So how did those decisions happen? And they turned out to become a brand. Whatever the brand may be, it became a brand. So I worked with, after doing my engineering, I worked with J&J. Harish Bijur was a name that came up. He used to be my colleague in those days. was a junior guy in HR, so you know that name rings a bell. After which I came here, and after the IIM I joined Sony. 5 years later I was head of marketing for Sony in India, and I decided that if I have to progress, I have to get some sales and branch management experience. So I moved to the ice cream industry and became the divisional manager of a large regional ice cream business.
Abhay, what I want is this. Tell us one great incident, because you had very eventful career in India, abroad, and several countries, where you actually did something very interesting, and you know that kind of turned out that it was a super duper decision. I mean, and lots of people within the organization, you're right, for a very long time we didn't have any internet or any way of broadcasting. And many times one starts wondering, do you really want to broadcast what you did? So you may want to be relevant to a bunch of guys who are around you, but do you really want to be relevant to whom? To whom? So anything that you did, because you must have had a very...
Well, yes and no, and that's good news and bad news actually. And I'll give you both, because you need to know both sides of that coin. I was, by virtue of being in the ice cream industry with a local firm here, I was selected, headhunted by Unilever in the Middle East to be the sales and distribution resource for their ice cream project in the Middle East, which was 6 countries. And during the process of that development, I developed a bunch of systems, concepts, etc., which were globally adopted, and I became a global ice cream resource. So I would travel globally to the UK, to the headquarters in Holland, etc., etc., and we would share best practice. And there were a couple of things which I had generated which was considered globally best practice. But there's a flip side to this. And the flip side is this. Most of Unilever's emerging market businesses were not built on soundly researched logic. And therefore, there was huge upfront investment, and the businesses bled for a long time. Now, in that context, I had a small little island of 6 countries where we had a market share of between 40 and 45% in every market. They wouldn't let me go. I couldn't progress within the company because they said we can't spare him from the business. I had to leave in order to progress my business.
Very interesting. See, this brings us to a problem which most brands, how long will you be a Clint Eastwood and Wild West? I mean, that for a very long time. But then you can't be pushed around also because the audience don't want to see you in that role. So the problem with most strong brands is they tend to get identified with something, but when you move out of your zone of discomfort, or you move into the zone of discomfort, it might mean a negative implication for you in the future. And that's really the choice. And we know that brands have to evolve. So how does one go about it? A quick humorous intervention about myself, about this branding business. And one of the first things they tell you about your brand is the brand name. And the problem I have, and all of us have, is our brand names were not chosen by us, but by our parents. And the interesting thing there is, for some reason, the imagination of most parents all over the country and world is, I think, limited. And so that's why you see so many names, so many guys with the name, something like John Smith all over you, the Anglo-Saxon world. How can you have a name? I mean, or it's pretty much like my name, right? I mean, just look at it. There must be at least 5 million guys with my name, Moorthi, in South India. Yeah, I mean, how does this brand stand out there? I mean, it's starting with a disadvantage, right? I mean, forget doing anything great, but even to get cracking, it's a big thing. And then you are left with initials, as some of our friends here, YLR. YLR, Yellow London Red. The full name is a jawbreaker, so again. So you know, that's it. So you are left with that, like the software guys call it, the unique part of the string. That's the first struggle I had, and yeah, inshallah, the journey is still going on. So, but I'll open to questions, and I think we have another 20 minutes maybe before we close. And quickly, yes, sir, we can, the gentleman there in the black T-shirt. Yes, sir.
I'm going to ask the first question, sir.
You?
Yeah.
I thought it was for the audience. Go ahead, quickly. And before you ask questions, one, A, like all good Indians, don't make statements, ask questions. Okay? Yeah, that's one problem I have seen with us as a race. Second, I asked the panel members actually to be brief, and
quick in their intervention so that we can take more questions. And I also request you to point to specific panel members. Fortunately, I don't need to answer any questions because I am the host.
Yes, sir.
Go on.
This goes to all the panel members here. Does the luck matters in personal branding?
No, suggest that you pick up one because, you know, we have to go because we have to go to, sir, pick up one of them.
So I go with Monika.
Monika, yes, sir. Yeah, pick up one of them because the reason is we would like to go to lots of questions.
I don't know, I don't know about luck, but definitely timing matters. And what you're trying to say at what time, that definitely has a role to play. But it's not so much luck as your understanding of the situation, what it is right for.
Yes, sir.
Thanks for the opportunity. My question is...
Hold it closer to your mouth, sir.
Can you hear me now? So when you speak about communicating values to others to sort of communicate your brand, what very often happens is that what you want to communicate is not what is perceived by people. Because a lot of people have a strong confirmation bias, you know, and while you might want to communicate, you know, great values about your work and sometimes, you know, that's
so your question is how does one handle distortion of communication? Is that the issue?
Yeah, I mean how when you're communicating your values that you want to communicate.
That's what it is. You said something but somebody else understood it or something else.
Yeah.
For whatever reasons. Yeah?
Correct.
Specific panelists, sir. Whom do you want to ask this?
The lady, please.
So,
the choice, Monika. The toast of today.
Often we use in branding, we use a concept of brand personality. And the thing is that what is your brand personality? What do you come across as? And that is, that is a result. It's a result of the things that you do in product, services, communication, pricing. But it is not direct. There is a filter in between, which what you spoke about. Which is what is the audience who you're talking to, who are they and what is their perception? So I process it, so I'm the brand is trying to communicate something, but you, a woman in Punjab versus you in IIMB in Bangalore, will process it in different ways. So the key is to identify the target. I'm just telling you from the branding perspective, it applies to personal. So who you want to appeal to, understand what their preconception, what their mindset is, and then communicate in a way that you get your point across or your values across.
Yeah, supplementary questions later, sir. Quickly, quick intervention. Yeah, yeah.
How do you sort of persuade people? Because it's very hard to persuade people to change their mind.
Yeah, let him answer. Let Abhay answer. Yeah, go on. Yeah.
So to take your question, there are two, three things. Because you have to remember that at the end of the day, your brand is what people believe you are, not what you say you are. So, first part of it is articulation. And that's an internal thing. And how well you articulate what
that's
you say is one part.
The question is simple, Abhay. The question he's saying is, despite all my effort, there is distortion. What do I do about it? That's really the point.
So one part is reinforcement. So, the more you reinforce, over a period of time, you will be able to reduce this gap between what you are and what people believe you are. And articulation and reinforcement is one part. The third part, which is something that we haven't discussed so far, which is your team out there, your network. How many people out there are actually batting for you? The more people talk about you when you're not in the room, will improve your image in many ways and clear these perception gaps.
Yes, sir. Right.
Yeah.
I think... go on and keep the question brief. No supplementary questions.
So my name is Parthiban and I have a question for Aniisu. So my question is, what is the right balance? So I just want to give a quick example. When you have Kailash Satyarthi, who's been such a low profile until he won the Nobel Prize, nobody knew. And this other side is, I don't know if everybody knows, is Vishen Lekhiani, who spends millions of dollars in YouTube to promote himself. So is both correct or is there a right balance?
Great question. I think that so personal brands thankfully can be built without really investing a lot of money. So on a shoestring budget or no budget at all, you can definitely build your personal brand. And I think what is related to that question is also about the cultural context in which we live. So in India, for example, it may sound And in fact, one of the audience members had asked me just outside the, when we were at the tea. He said, we are usually humble people. As Indians, we don't want to boast about ourselves. So is that a good thing to do if you go and talk about a personal brand? So it is not about boasting about yourself. It is not about, you know, tom-tomming what you do. It's more about sharing. So if you see it in that context, you need to be just letting your network know what you do. And that itself leads to your personal brand getting built over time. So I know in the American context, it might be about, yes, go and market yourself, put as much as money as you want, but you can still build your brand with or with very limited amount of money. Does that answer Quentin's question?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
My question is to Mr. Verghese again. So the question is that how do you handle a brand disaster in a personal branding?
Okay, so yeah, brand, I mean, it all depends on what is the disaster and what you qualify as a disaster. So let me look at even some examples. So if Lance Armstrong, very well-known brand, and then he fell by the wayside because of, you know, what he did in terms of doping and all that. Now, that is definitely a brand disaster, because not just for him personally, but also for the brands who are associated with him. And you could even look at Tiger Woods. So another example, and then you are caught philandering and your wife, you know, leaves you and all that, and all the other brands start dropping out of the way because they don't want to be associated with you. So these are definitely brand disasters. So the only way is to be honest and upfront and say, yes, you're sorry. I think starting with that, and then of course make remedial corrections and try to, you know, rectify it. So for example, what I know is Tiger Woods is coming back, at least in terms of golf, he's coming back. But that disaster is not going to go away. It is still there in people's memories. It just depends on how long you're going to, you know, it's going to be there. Likewise, Lance Armstrong is now, I believe, doing some podcast series which talks about, you know, how he can be more humble and things like that, which is again a way of coming back. But of course, they have a PR machinery behind this to help them out. And for us, we can't all afford PR, you know, agencies to do this nice curation of our brand. Because if it's not authentic, people will still catch you out.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay. So
once
just
again. She goes on. Okay. And after that, him. And your question, brief, specific to one panelist.
In regards to a corporate environment, right? We're so caught up in our work. So how important is it, or rather, what is the overlap between personal branding, image coming in, and grooming? How important are all of these? How interlinked are they? So that's like a, because I can be an expert in whatever I do, but how if I walk in with my arrogance of saying, okay, I'm really great at what I do, so accept what I'm saying, and walk in with a not a very corporate this one, there can be a flip side to it. So how important is it for you to personally take it up? That's my question.
Who are you asking the question to? Who are you referring the question to? Yes, Abhay.
So it is. It could be very important. It could be important, or it could be nice to have. It all depends on whether you're a front office job, whether you're in a leadership role, whether you're in a back office job doing logistics, working with, you know, in shorts at the back. It all depends. So personal grooming and those aspects and how you carry yourself is related to that. In respect to wearing your attitude on a sleeve, typically those things work when it is, whatever the role is, extremely individualistic and not other people related. So in 100% of the cases, when other people are involved, whether you manage them, whether you are managed, or whether you have to work in teams or groups, attitude on the sleeve is a formula for disaster. Yeah. Does that help? Have I covered everything you asked?
Right. Yeah. Yes, sir. There's some question from him. Yeah.
Hello, sir. My name is Karthik. My question is to Mr. Abhay. In the corporate environment, how do we rebrand ourselves? Say, already there is a brand for our side. So now we realize that we have to reposition ourselves or something. So how difficult it is, and can you give some examples as well?
Okay. The thing is, there are 2-3 things. Rebranding in terms of professional expertise or domain expertise is an easy thing to do. So if you, I gave my own example where I worked in marketing first, then sales and distribution. Later on, I was negotiating sales and distribution contracts with the worst lawyers in the world, tobacco lawyers. That was a $500 million contract with BAT. So, you know, my expertise has moved with the time, but starting from what I was doing earlier. That's an easy one to do in terms of rebranding, and it enables you to have a much larger, wider, more interesting canvas of your professional capabilities. That will take you forward. If, however, you've had a, you know, you're not making career progression at the pace that you believe you deserve, and you want to probably rebrand, then that's a different matter. Yeah, and there are multiple things that contribute towards career progression in the corporate environment. It's not just performance. Yeah, so you got to be damn good at your job. If not, everything else is not as important. But sometimes, even if you're damn good at your job, you don't progress. Yeah, because it also, what is important is that you have to show the ability to do the next level job well. And the third is that opportunity has to come. But more importantly, names get referred for specific positions that come up. And these referrals come not necessarily from immediate boss or whatever. It comes through a collection of various people and what they think about you. And therefore, it is very, very important that you need to have and understand who the influencers are for the path that you are choosing for your own career progression, and ensure that they think well of you.
Right. How to become a corporate citizen? Some questions from the leftists. Yes, sir. Because we have had them from the right. Yes,
can I take the question first?
The gentleman there with the t-shirt.
One question.
Sir, later, sir. Because we have to take them. Because we can't. Yeah. Right up there.
To the panel, anybody in a large corporation or in real life, we talked about outside in, right? Outside in approach. There are conflicting interests, right? Like you tune your brand communication to a particular group or a particular audience, it can actually conflict with another interest. Say a finance director will not go in line probably with the logistics director. So how do you not end up in a confused positioning in that kind of a scenario? Thanks.
So who are you asking this question?
I mean anybody, it's okay.
Yes, madam, go ahead. Or why don't you give to Aakarsh?
I'll take the next question. Corporate, I think.
Right, okay, right. You take the next question,
yeah.
All right, fine.
Yeah, we cannot be everything to everyone. And they say that strategy is more about not doing something than doing something. So yeah, once you identify your audience and you have a certain value that you deliver to them, there are others who will not identify with that value, and you run the risk of leaving them out. That's fair, and that you should be ready to accept. But it's not like we are stuck in one position. We evolve, like that question. You can rebrand yourself. Like, if you look at Bill Gates, he was a solid corporate type. He led Microsoft. But over the last decade, how he has rebranded himself as a philanthropist, completely different target segment. So it's possible to do, but it's just that when you're there, you do it in the best way possible, and you cater to all the needs of your audience and provide the value. So you will alienate some people, but then you can also make the transition too. And there is now increasingly the thinking is moving towards systems thinking from rather just brand and design thinking, where you have to step back and look at the whole system and look at the interconnections and then figure out, okay, which is the best leverage point? Where can I make the most impact so that the most of the system is impacted? But it's difficult to think so much for ourselves and live like that.
Yeah.
Just going to add to that, to your specific question of the finance director and the the supply chain director, and you're working in the engineering department. See, there is a difference between domain expertise and value creation. Yeah, you may be a domain expert. How do you, as a domain expert, influence the finance director when there is no interaction? but you can if he understands the value you create for the company. Yeah, does
it's,
that help?
It's not only having a great idea, it's also the ability to be able to communicate, I think. Yes, sir, your question, yes.
Sir, I'm Gopal Krishna. This question is for Abhay, my batchmate. Can you give a quick comment on the brand of CCD and Siddharth, the late Siddharth?
Oh dear. See, the as a brand, he was a great success. And that brand disappeared like switching off a light. Right?
Who was that?
Like switching off a light.
No, no. Who was the brand?
He's talking of Siddharth.
Okay. Coffee Day.
Okay.
I'm not going to get into what happened in there and why he did what he did, because that's controversial and this is not the forum. But Siddharth created a very successful brand, considering the background that he was and what he did. Was he a successful entrepreneur? I'm not sure. Did he build the brand and provide the appropriate leadership to build that business? I'm not sure. But as a brand, it was very good. It just got switched off one fine day.
Right. Yes, sir. One last question from, yes, this gentleman. And you may want to answer, Aakarsh. Yes.
Morning. My name is Samir Gupta. We started the day with saying a standout. And when you stand out, you have some values to stand out. Now, in the corporate setup, when you stand up for your values, which is against the vision and mission of the corporate, you get thrown out. That's exactly what I'm using the words. You get thrown out. I got thrown out thrice in my life. So what is it that makes you different there, that when you're thrown out and you still stand for the same values, do you still continue to do that or just
quickly,
go
you
there?
Can also leave, by the way.
Yep.
Okay, yeah. Not necessary. Somebody throws you out. If there's a mismatch, you can leave. Yes, sir.
So I think again the question is about corporate. So I'll let them answer, and then after that, I'll give my thoughts.
Yeah.
On
Yeah. Can I give it to Aniisu? Yeah. Okay. Give it to Aniisu. Yeah.
Well, I can relate to what you're saying because, and again, not taking names of organizations, but there have been situations where I have faced similar kind of cases where I had to decide whether I want to stay on and do something or move on. And I have taken the step of going against senior people who have been unethical or there have been conflicts of interest. And yes, it has impacted my career in that sense. But I know I can go to sleep well because I've done the right thing and I've lived by the values. And also around me, people start respecting you more because of what you have done, whether your team or whether you're stakeholders. So, in a sense, I think I would advise to go with your values because that's what's going to keep you, that's going to stand the test of time, I would say.
Yes, sir. I think we have time for one more question, the gentleman in the T-shirt, IIM T-shirt, yeah. Yeah. Choice always goes to IIM. Yeah.
So I carried the brand today on the T-shirt. So we started the day by defining it as the amount of value we add to others. There's also a fine balance of not becoming validation junkie, people trying to earn the validation of people all the time. So how do we balance ourselves while we have the outside in approach? How do we balance ourselves not becoming too conscious about what people think of me?
Become a slave of fame, so that's the problem. Yes.
Slave of fame.
Yeah. Sure.
So, I'd like to just take a couple of minutes to give my perspectives on the questions that were asked. I'll keep it very, very brief. So there were points on luck, then branding disasters, then opportunities getting created, and now about the validation aspect. So the first one, to answer your point, luck is important if you have to see the mass kind of a scale. There has to be one moment, one defining moment in your path that will put you out there in the limelight. So you can still be a known brand in a certain niche, but if you have to go really mainstream, there has to be one life-changing moment. So that, I think, luck would matter at a bigger scale. The next one is about branding disasters. I personally believe, and I've seen, that branding is more like a cycle. So you've seen ministers, chief ministers, they come to power, they go off power, next time they come. Similarly, there are a lot of these controversies by sports persons, and then actors. So they've gone through those controversies, they've come back, you know, Salman Khan had his share of controversies, now he's doing Being Human or whatever, he's coming back. So you need to be fearless to experiment, but not be too reckless with whatever you're trying. So it's okay to have those kind of, you know, cycles to go through in terms of your branding. The other bit is in terms of being perceived as a domain expertise and what kind of opportunities it can give. One recent example of myself was through my videos and articles that I write, I was discovered and, you know, I was discovered by Facebook. So I was offered to lead their startup programs in India and South Asia. Not because I had number of years of experience, but because I was perceived as a domain expert within the startup domain. I'd take up that and work very briefly with Facebook, but you know, that is what being a domain expert would give you, different kinds of opportunities, especially now when they're looking for specialization over generalization. And the final point on, you know, validation of how people perceive. See, one thing very, very important to keep in mind is reach versus engagement. It is not like, you know, you need to have a lot of followers, you know, who are following you, but are not engaged very deeply with you. I don't think that is a great brand. I think a greater brand would be the one which would have lesser number of followers, but they're very highly engaged with you. A good example of that would be your, you know, the small bakery shops or the, you know, restaurants, like, so a Paradise restaurant, which was a small restaurant in Hyderabad, was very popular within Hyderabad, but now they've scaled and, you know, they have franchises across the country now. So it is really, really important to be known for being very good with whatever you're doing. So focus on the engagement, and then that will create a number of brand evangelists, people who will talk for you. That will give the scale, and eventually you will reach those numbers. So I think that's where, yeah.
Great, sir. We completely run out of time.